8:55 Eastern Daylight Time, and Columbia and its affiliated stations bring you Elmer Davis and the news.
Today's fighting was confused, obscure, and still indecisive, but the Allies seem to have counterattacked more effectively than at any time since the breakthrough last Thursday. Arras was retaken this morning, according to a French official statement. And while the Germans do not admit this, the French stick to their story and say that a battle described as chaotic took place to the eastward of Arras from Cambrai to Valenciennes. Here the Allied army based on the Channel ports, though still encircled, has gained itself more elbow room and is trying to meet other French forces moving up from St. Quentin. If this movement is completed, the Germans in the Somme Valley will be encircled. Reports that the French had retaken Abbeville on the Channel are not confirmed in Paris, where they admit they don't know the situation on the coast. However, German claims that they have extended their lines 30 miles up the shore are ridiculed by the French, who say that this might refer to a dash by a small group of motorcyclists. Farther east, the Germans have captured Rethel, and it was said in Berlin that it was most likely that they had taken Soissons, but this was not positively claimed and is not confirmed. And our Paris correspondent, Mr. Grandin, reported that there is some action now along the Rio Maginot line. Practically all this information, except the French story of the recapture of Arras, comes from unofficial or semi-official sources. The French official communique tonight said nothing definite at all, neither did the German communique this morning, and tonight we have had no statement from the German high command. It seems probable that neither general headquarters really knows much about what is going on in this confusion of interlocking battles, and perhaps still more probable that each side is afraid to tell what it does know for fear of giving the enemy information which he does not yet possess. The Germans say that today they drove the Dutch out of Maritime Flanders, the strip of Dutch territory just west of Antwerp, and that their forces moving south from that area are fighting desperately around Ghent and on the Upper Scheldt. This is, of course, a blow at the left flank of the Channel Army, whose right flank is engaged at Cambrai. But our correspondent Russell Hill reported this evening that military circles in Berlin do not expect any quick victory, and the general tone of the Germans seems somewhat less confident than in the last few days. The British Air Force continued its night raids on Germany, attacking particularly the railroad yards at Aachen and Krefeld, and the Germans say their bombers sank a cruiser and several merchantmen in the Channel. Also, they appear to be using fast motor torpedo boats against Channel shipping. And after days of fair, dry weather favorable to the operation of planes and tanks, there was rain in France today. The French are hoping for more. What our London correspondent Mr. Murrow describes as the British Revolution occurred today peacefully and constitutionally when within 3 hours Parliament passed a bill giving the government full control over all persons and property. This was the summary of the measure by Major Attlee, leader of the Labour Party and member of the War Cabinet, who presented it to the House of Commons. The government can dictate production, expand or shut down factories, destroy property when necessary, draft anybody's labor for any purpose, and will impose 100% tax on excess profits. The bill passed with practically no argument. Minister of Supply Herbert Morrison ordered all British munitions factories on a 24-hour day, 7 days a week. It was announced by the Allied Purchasing Mission that British and French planes bought here are in some cases being flown across the Atlantic, presumably from Newfoundland. They cannot, of course, be flown from this country to either Newfoundland or Canada under the neutrality law. After lunching with the President today, Governor Landon said that Republican leaders could join the cabinet in a coalition administration only if the President would announce that he would not take a third-term nomination even if offered. If he would eliminate himself, said Mr. Landon, he would become the leader of the nation instead of the head of a party. In response to this, Mr. Roosevelt said tonight, I quote, "The president regrets that he has not the time just now to give to the preparation of political statements," end quote. It was reported in Washington that the president had offered to make Mr. Landon, Colonel Frank Knox, and Colonel William J. Donovan, secretaries of War, the Navy, and Labor, respectively. The State Department tonight advised all Americans in the British Isles who want to come home to proceed to Galway, Ireland, where the liner President Roosevelt will be sent to bring them back. Belligerent governments are asked to look after the voyage and see that nothing happens to it. And tonight at 10:30 Eastern Daylight Time, Senator James F. Burns of South Carolina will speak on most of these stations, replying to Colonel Lindbergh.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.